All right, we're going to be taking a few notes on some of the long-term causes, actually causes of World War I, and we'll use the acronym MANIA to remember those causes. So right now, you should be working on a sheet that looks like this. I'm going to line this up. It looks like this. This is going to be pasted into your Social Studies composition book. So we're going to write some notes on these causes of World War I. Get this out of the way. All right, and again, we're going to use the acronym MANIA, and that will represent militarism, alliances, nationalism, imperialism, and the assassination of the Archduke Franz Ferdinand. Long-term causes. So now you're writing these notes in your composition book. Militarism is the building up of armed forces and getting ready for war. So this is something that European countries, around the turn of the century, and remember that always means 1800s into 1900s, European countries were doing this, and right through the early 1900s, many people, not only in Europe, but in the United States and other developed countries too, suspected that this aggressive practice was going to end up leading to some kind of catastrophic war. No one believed that it would be catastrophic for their country. They believed that it would be devastating for their enemies and opponents. Second cause is a system of alliances. Alliances are agreements or promises to help another country, and European countries were forming all kinds of alliances with one another, sometimes secret, sometimes out in the open. Remember last year you studied George Washington's presidency, and upon leaving office after two terms, one of the things Washington said was, you know, his advice to the American people, to future politicians, future presidents, to stay out of these European alliances. And that was something that Washington said back in the late 1700s, in the 1790s. And here we are in the early 1900s, and it's still a problem. We'll take a moment to write down some of the alliances, the two different alliances. The Triple Alliance, this is the name of the alliance before the war began. As the war does begin and progresses, the Triple Alliance becomes known as the Central Powers, and you'll see why in a moment when we look at a map. Germany, Austria-Hungary, and the Ottoman Empire. Today, the country of Turkey is much smaller than the much larger Ottoman Empire, but just to give you a sense of where this was, we'll in parentheses, just write down Turkey. The other alliance, the opposing alliance, was the Triple Entente. Again, as the war began and continued to progress, these countries became known as the Allied Powers, and they included Russia, France, and Great Britain. And you'll notice that the United States is not part of this. One of the things that we'll see is that the United States really wanted to stay out of this war altogether. All right, let's take a moment to complete the map, which is another handout, and I'm going to just slide this back over here for a second. So you should have a map that looks like this with some countries to label, and then we'll shade in with colored pencils or crayons, highlighters if you want, the Allied Powers, the Central Powers, and the Neutral Nations. Slide this out of the way, come back to our map. So if you take a look at this map, you might want to pause the video right here. And I believe that everything that's on that sheet, and again, we're going to paste that into your Socialist Composition book. I believe that everything that you're asked to label is here, with possibly the exception of Ireland. So Ireland is right here, where you see my mouse right now. That's Ireland. You're asked to find Great Britain, Ireland, France, Belgium, you see, Italy, Spain, Russia, the Netherlands, right here, it's abbreviated N-E-T-H, you can abbreviate it as well. Germany, Austria-Hungary, Switzerland, S-W-I-T-Z, you can abbreviate that as well. Serbia, right here. Ottoman Empire, Bulgaria. I believe those are the only countries that you have to label. And then we can just shade in those main Allied powers. On this map, they're green. And then the Central Powers, and again, I mentioned that when you see the map, you can see why they're called the Central Powers, because you've got Allied countries on either side. And then the countries that are pink on this map are ones that were neutral. So again, you might want to just pause this video right now to compare this map and help use it to help you label yours. All right, moving on to cause number three, it's nationalism. This is having pride in one's country and being ready to defend it. So again, I'm just going to backtrack and refresh your memory. We've got militarism. These countries are building up powerful militaries, and they're willing to use them. They're forming entangling alliances with one another, sometimes secret alliances. So if one country, an ally of theirs, gets into a fight with another country, they have to jump in and help out, even if it's a conflict that has nothing to do with them. Countries are, they're prideful, and they're willing to do anything that their leaders ask them to do, no matter how outrageous. Fourth cause is imperialism. And this is where countries, you know, of course, we've talked about imperialism, where countries are gobbling up territories. European countries are focusing on Africa and Asia, Southern Asia. But this is making them rivals of one another. This is creating jealousies and bitterness. And when you mix all of that, the alliances, the militarism, the pride, it's just a recipe for disaster. The fifth cause, and this is really, the heading there says long-term causes. This is really the spark, actually. This is the short-term and immediate cause that starts the conflict. And it's the assassination of the Archduke Franz Ferdinand. The Archduke, the heir to the Austro-Hungarian throne, is assassinated while in Bosnia by a Serb nationalist. I'm going to tell you a story in class about the assassination. I'm not going to do that here because Serbia was blamed by, just to cover that, Austria for assassinating the Archduke. Austria ends up declaring war on Serbia. Now, Serbia has a very powerful ally in Russia. Russia declares war on Austria-Hungary to defend Serbia. Austria-Hungary has other allies, powerful allies itself, namely Germany. So Germany gets involved in the act, and this whole system of these entangling alliances comes into play. And within a matter of weeks following the Archduke's assassination, the entire continent, virtually the entire continent, is at war.